Can I ask you a simple question? Do you think we need to consider changing, amending, altering the system?
Mm-hmm.
Do we need to consider changing, amending, altering the system?
Once again, it is a matter for debate. I may have views on the matter.
I'm asking for your views.
My view? Well, I think some kind of revisiting is required.
What sort of revisiting would that be?
Well, creating a more efficient system. Efficient, I'm not talking in terms of the beauty of the judgments of the thing, but in terms of the working of the system. Look here, we have some 50,000 and odd pending cases. Whether all these cases are really required to be dealt by the Supreme Court is one question. A couple of years back, maybe 3 years back, I had the honor of delivering H.R. Khanna Memorial Lecture. I dealt with this problem. This multiple benches itself is a contributor of a great problem of dependency. So therefore it requires some analysis, some examination and restructuring of the whole system. That's what I believe. But it requires a full-scale debate. It can't be just a one-line answer, can't be possible in this.
The next question, Justice Chelameswar, refers to something you wrote in your famous letter of November to the Chief Justice about allocation of cases to preferred benches.
Back to that again.
Oh, the question, not me, sir. The question. When you write to the CJI for allocating important cases to senior judges in a court where every judge is equal, then are you suggesting that senior judges are more equipped in dealing with important questions?
First of all, did we mention the word senior in that letter anywhere?
But I'm only reading the question.
So that's the answer. We never said senior. See, nothing like, see, at this stage, when each one of us sitting in the Supreme Court, barring a few who came from directly from the bar, each one of us must have spent at least 15, 16 years in high courts around that. And coming here, but at this stage, what is the seniority? Seniority is not the question here. Seniority for certain purposes, because the system, when the second judge's case said collegium should be the first three judges. Well, only for certain purposes, not for the purposes of deciding cases. Ultimately, the importance of the judgment depends upon the quality of the judgment, not to who decided it. What reasons are given, what logic is given, what jurisprudential principle was laid down there. That's what matters, not how senior he is or how junior he is, quote unquote.
This next question seems to refer very possibly to a position you share, I'm assuming. It's talking about how judges choose judges. Mm-hmm. The question is talking about how judges in India choose judges. And the question is this a democratic way of deciding the issue of the appointment of judges? Doesn't this go against the principle of natural justice of not being allowed to decide in one's own cause?
I don't know, it's too complicated a question because there are too many concepts rolled into it. What is this natural justice about it? There's nothing like natural justice in these matters. Natural justice is a totally different concept. Now, judges playing a role in the matter of the choice of next generation of judges, well, it's a part of the Indian democracy. That's what happened over a period of 70 years. Unless you think that there is a prototype of democracy which is required to be followed everywhere in the world. All democracy is an experiment, wherever it is.
Our last question. What is the one common problem that all our institutions face? What is the one common problem that all our institutions face and what is the solution?
What the father of the nation told us, speak truth. That solves a lot of problems if we speak, all of us speak truth. That solves a lot of the problems in this country.
You're saying the problem is a lot of us lie.
Well, we may not lie, but we speak half-truths. Half-truths. In fact, anyway, the context now that it's over, there's a wonderful book published almost 15 years back on Mughal India, titled The Last Spring by somebody called Mr. Abraham Irani, is no more. In the epilogue, he writes about the Mughal society. Hypocrisy and psychopancy are the hallmarks of the Mughal India, he said. Indians hardly, seldom spoke. They communicated in knots and metaphors, which made it easy for them to break faith and still feel decent. That's what he wrote. And 500 years later, I don't think we're much different from that.
Justice Chelameswar, we've come to the end. Before I ask Shobhana Rana to come and move the vote of thanks, I want to personally thank you for having agreed to answer these questions. Once again, I want to emphasize for having given the English language two very wonderful ways of saying yes. A charming smile and that articulate word,
Maybe it's my own inadequacy, Mr. Thapar.
No, sir, it's not your inadequacy. It's your very clever, discreet way of confirming without using the word yes. I applaud you, sir. I applaud you.